Hi everyone. Now we are going to discuss about a disease called rabies, which is one of the type of zoonotic diseases. This rabies disease has been recognized from very ancient times as a disease that occurs primarily in animals and is transmitted to humans. So here are some of the mammals where they are getting affected by this rabies. And this is the photograph of the rabies virus. Okay, then this is a electronic microscopic figure of a rabies virus. So here you can see it's a shape of a bullet shaped virus. Now this rabies is a Latin word derived from a Latin word called rabri, which means rage or madness. So rabies is going to be an acute infection of central nervous system that is almost fatal. That means once we are going to have the peak of this rabies infection, obviously it is going to lead to the death of the person. And it is going to be caused by a virus belonging to the family called Rabidoviridae or rabidovirus. And as I already told you, it's going to be called as a zoonotic disease, as it is going to be transmitted to humans from the bite of a rabid animal. Any mammal, that means all the types of mammals get this rabies disease, include rabbit, cattle, cats, dogs, bats, foxes, etc. That means including us, all mammals are going to be affected with this rabies virus. And the causative agent, that means about the causative agent of this rabies is, it's highly neurotrophic rabies virus. That means the nervous system is going to be damaged, so obviously caused as a neurotrophic rabies virus, belonging to the family called as that means Rabidoviridae that we have discussed, and the genus is Lyssa. Lyssa in Greek, it means rage, that means rabies virus. So Lyssa means it's a rabies virus. In Greek, the Lyssa means rage. So as I already told you, this is a bullet-shaped virus which is having an envelope. Okay, so this is an enveloped virus and containing a genetic material as a single-stranded RNA. So the genetic material or genome that is present in the rabies virus is single-stranded RNA. So here this bullet-shaped or rod-shaped virus is going to measure about 75 into 180 nanometers. So the length and breadth is going to be of about 75 into 180 nanometers in measurement. And this envelope is going to be made up of lipoprotein, that is lipid plus protein in nature. So here you can see this is an spikes and this is the envelope that it is having. Okay, then it is going to have the knob-like spikes composed of glycoproteins. That means a glycogen plus protein. So that is going to be called as glycoprotein. So here are all the spikes that are present. Okay, spike means some sort of a lollipop shape one. These are all going to be called as spikes. And inside to this envelope, that is where whatever the glycolipid layer is there, that is lipoprotein layer is there, this envelope is going to cover a thing called as nucleocapsid. So this we are going to call it as ribonucleocapsid. As the genetic material is RNA, we call this as ribonucleocapsid. And this genome, as I told you, is a single stranded RNA and it is having the negative sense. And there is a specific type of the enzyme that is present here is nothing but the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, which is very essential for the replication of this virus. Then moving to the cultural characters of this rabies virus, this can be grown in chick embryos and as well as in the tissue cultures. That means the rabies virus can be cultivated both in the chick embryos and the tissue cultures. So for example, if you are going to culture these viruses in the chick embryos, the virus is usually inoculated into the yolk sac of the embryo. Then the serial propagation in the chick embryos has led to the development of attenuated vaccine strain called Flory and Kelvy. Okay, and then coming to the other adapted strain to duck egg. So this strain is also given to the duck egg. And then it also have prepared the what we call it as inactivated vaccines. Later on, the several that means we are going to have several primary as well as the continuous cell cultures that was taken from the chick embryo fibroblast or mouse neuroblastoma or even human diploid lung fibroblast were also used to cultivate it. Out of all those things, Vero monkey kidney cells with minimal are used to grow rabies virus. And now the fixed virus. So what is it means? We'll discuss once again. The fixed virus strains grow in human diploid lung fibroblast and even the chick embryo and Vero monkey kidney cell cultures are used for the vaccine production. So either it may be the propagation in the chick embryos or in the Vero monkey kidney cells, they are all being used to propagate. That means to prepare the vaccines. So it may be of attenuated vaccines or it may be of other vaccine production again as this rabies virus. Okay, so then moving to the rabies virus sensitivity, it is going to be of very sensitive to ethanol, iodine, then quaternary ammonium salts and even the soaps, detergents and lipid solvents such as ether and chloroform. And it is inactivated by some sort of formalin, phenol, UV light or sunlight. So rabies virus survives, that means it is going to survive and you are going to keep the rabies virus at 4 degrees centigrade for weeks together. That means it won't get destroyed. At 4 degrees centigrade, it is going to remain like that for weeks together. Okay, so then moving to the next one, that is epidemiology. So all warm-blooded animals, as I told you, all warm-blooded animals are going to be including humans or can be infected. So what are warm-blooded animals? So I told you that cattle, cats, foxes are going to be of more highly susceptible, whereas fowl, birds, frogs, snakes are resistant to rabies. That means the rabies virus cannot infect these ones, that is below the reptiles. And then coming to the virus, as I told you, it is going to be distributed in the infected animals, especially in nervous system, saliva, urine, lymph, milk, that is the colostrum of the mother feeding. That's why it's mainly in the mammals and blood. Rabies virus isolated from natural human or animal infection is termed as street virus. That means the virus that you are isolating from the infected animal is going to be called as street virus. And if that virus is going to have the serial intercerebral passages in rabbits, the virus undergoes certain changes and becomes fixed or mutant virus. So you're going to change or alter the nature of the virus and that is going to be fixed. That means further it can't be changed. So that is going to be called as fixed or mutant virus. And these fixed viruses are mainly used for vaccine production. So let's have a glance about this fixed virus and as well as the street virus. Okay, so as I already told you, one whose virulence and incubation period have been stabilized by serial passage and remain fixed during further transformation is going to be called as fixed virus. That means a rabies virus that has undergone serial passages through rabbits. For example, here we are going to serial passage this virus in the rabbits, thus stabilizing its virulence and incubation period. Such type of the virus is going to be called as fixed virus. Then what is a street virus? The virulent rabies virus from a rabid domestic animal, the infected animal, that has contracted the disease from a bite or a scratch of another animal is going to be called as street virus. So this is the difference between the fixed virus and the street virus. Okay, so this street virus is going to be opposed to a laboratory adapted strain of the virus. Then coming to the pathogenesis, so these are the several steps that is occurring in the infection process. That is first step, after the after inoculation of the virus by the bite of this rabid animal, it may be a dog or some other animal, a region of the virus glycoprotein. So we have seen that spikes are present on the virus. Those will attach to the plasma membrane of nearby skeletal muscle cells. Now this virus enters the cell, that means inside it will go and multiply, that means the virus gets multiplied. So the multiplication of the virus occurs. When the concentration of the muscle virus is sufficient, the virus enters the nervous system through unmyelinated sensory and motor terminals through a binding site called as nicotinic acetylcholine receptor. So here is a stage where it is going to occur. Now once it has gone to the receptor, the virus spreads by retrogranal axonal flow. That is, you are going to have the axonal. That flow of the speed will be of about 8 to 20 millimeters per day. And this will travel like this until it reaches the spinal cord. Once it is going to reach the spinal cord, the first specific symptom of the disease, that is pain and the paresthesia at the wound site, may occur. So obviously these are the stages until it is going to reach. Now what happens? A rapidly progressive encephalitis develops as the virus disseminates through the central nervous system. Now again it is going to disseminate through the cell, that is our central nervous system. Now the virus then spreads throughout the body along the peripheral nerves. Okay, with the help of peripheral nerves it is going to spread throughout the body, including those present in the salivary glands where it is shed in the saliva. Now within the brain neurons, the virus produces some sort of characteristic inclusion bodies known as Negri bodies. What we call it as Negri bodies. So these Negri bodies, I'll tell you what are these and in the coming slide. Okay, so these are the different steps that is happening in the pathogenesis. So the virus enters into the body via the animal bite, that is a rabid infected animal, and now here at the site of bite the virus gets multiplied in the muscle cells. So once it is going to be more in number, it will enter into the peripheral nervous system, moves by retrograde transport at the speed of 8 to 20 millimeters per day, and this will travel until it is going to reach the spinal cord. So once it is going to reach it, the virus replicates in the dorsal root ganglion and travels up and then to brain. And now the brain is infected, and the infected brain can be identified by having some sort of a Negri bodies. And from there, virus travels from brain via peripheral nervous systems to all over the body, such as eyes, kidneys, salivary glands, all those things. Now the saliva is going to have this virus. When this infected animal is going to bite the other one or scratch it, obviously this virus can enter into the other person. So this is what: deposition of the rabies infected saliva deep into the striated muscle. Now rabies virus replicate in the muscle cells, then enters the peripheral nerves, replication of virus in the dorsal ganglion, ascent of virus in the spinal cord. From then it is going to enter into the brainstem, cerebellum and other brain structures by the virus, and from there it is descending infection via nervous system to the eye, salivary glands and other organs. So then what are the symptoms that we can recognize whether we are infected with the rabies or not? So beginning, you are going to have that means the symptoms of rabies usually begin between 2 to 16 weeks after viral exposure, which is going to include some sort of anxiety, then irritability, depression, fatigue, loss of appetite, fever, and this is very important, a sensitivity to light and sound. Now the disease quickly progresses to a stage of paralysis. Now after that you are going to have a painful spasms of the throat, that means you will have a throat pain for swallowing or even the liquids also, and chest muscles occur when the patient swallow the liquids. So therefore this the mere sight, thought or smell of water can set off spasms. Even if they are going to sense the water or see the water also, they will feel the sense of spasm pain. So therefore rabies has been called as hydrophobia. Hydrophobia means fear of water. And the death results from destruction of the regions of the brain that regulate the breathing. So if the destruction of the regulating breath, the nerves of the regulating breath is going to be destroyed, so obviously we are going to die. Then how can we diagnose this rabies? So laboratory diagnosis, rabies is going to be diagnosed in the laboratory by examining the that is mainly the tissue samples. So the most common method used for diagnosis is demonstration of rabies via their antigens. So what kind of antigens? By the immunofluorescence technique, use it to demonstrate the rabies virus antigens, the spikes, all the things, lycoprotein spikes or the lycoprotein membrane. So these are all going to be called as rabies virus antigens. The demonstration of the Negri bodies, I told you, here are the Negri bodies which can be identified in the brain. So these Negri bodies, what are these Negri bodies? These Negri bodies, you can see they are of a oval in shape or round shape, which are present in the eosinophil cells, the masses of virus or unassembled viral subunits found in the cytoplasm that are visible in the light microscope. Okay, and the Negri bodies are going to be found in the brain by biopsy or postmortem sampling. A more rapid and sensitive method is isolation of the virus in the tissue culture lines, and virus growth is identified by immunofluorescence. So we can perform these all diagnosis methods to identify the virus. The postmortem can be done only after the death of the person. That is another thing. So when we don't know the cause of the person's death, so then the postmortem will be done, and that is going to show whether the body is going to have any infection, prior infection like rabies, all those things. If we find the Negri bodies in the brain, obviously we can think that the person has infected with the rabies virus. Then moving to the prevention and control, that is nothing but the prophylaxis. So here in the prevention and control involved the pre-exposure vaccines of humans at special risk. So who is going to be at the special risk? That means some of the animals like dogs and cats, and post-exposure vaccination of humans. And even pre-exposure of vaccination will also be given to humans at a special risk, like veterinaries and laboratory personnel who will grow these animals in their lab. And specific prophylaxis is generally employed after exposure to infection, and therefore it is called as anti-rabic treatment. We call that as anti-rabic treatment. This consists of a local treatment as well as anti-rabic vaccines and hyperimmune serum. So these are all the things that are given in the anti-rabic treatment. Then what is a local treatment? The bite of a wound should be washed with soap and water. This is a general practices that we can see in our villages and the towns where the first aid is going to be given when we are having any dog bite, isn't it? So as soon as a rabid dog is going to bite us, we are supposed to wash that wound immediately with soap and water, and then it is going to be treated with iodine or quaternary ammonium compounds or alcohols. So this is going to be treated as a very important step in the prevention of rabies, as soap and water can, that means they can destroy the virus effectively. Whereas in the case of severe wounds, anti-rabic serum may be applied topically and infiltrated around the wound. Okay, and then we are going to have some sort of anti-rabic vaccines, and they are going to be of three different kinds. One is going to be called as neural vaccines, then non-neural vaccines and recombinant vaccines. What are these neural vaccines? These neural vaccines are consisting of suspension of nervous tissues of animal cells, that means animals infected with fixed rabies virus, and then they are associated with the risk of neurological complications. So we'll get the side effects with these kind of vaccines. Then what are non-neural vaccines? These vaccines are produced either in embryonated eggs or in the tissue cultures, such as human diploid cell cultures or cell strains, we can call it as human diploid cell strains. Simply we call it as HDCs. Okay, And then the third type is going to be the recombinant vaccines, which are going to be the glycoprotein subunit on the virus surface, which is a protective antigen, has been cloned and recombinant vaccines were produced. That means the outer spike containing this glycoprotein layer was taken, and from that we are going to prepare the vaccines, and such type of the vaccines are called as recombinant vaccines, which are widely used at present and which is not having any side effects like these two, that is neural vaccines and the non-neural vaccines. So this is all about the prevention and control of these rabies infection. Okay, I hope so you understood very well. So in this part we had gone through the causative organism, then we had gone through the what are the growth characters of it, then pathogenesis, then we had gone with the laboratory diagnosis, epidemiology, and finally we dealt with the prophylaxis measures. Okay, so this is all about the rabies infection, which is one of the type of zoonotic diseases. Thank you.